cleaning up the environment. Perhaps I'd like to ask Mr. DeArmond, Mr. Baker, and Mr. Levenhagen, as they represent industries in this area, how you feel about this, if you feel tax incentives should be offered to companies that do install pollution controls, how you feel this affects your growth, expansion, other factors. Mr. DeArmond?
We at Chanlock are involved in noise pollution. If you want to talk about that, in the forging industry. It gets into OSHA. EPA kind of crowds that a little bit. However, it's more oriented toward protection of the machine user. The OSHA rulings say that you must machine or engineer noise out of the machine. In a forge hammer, you have two pieces of steel coming together. It's kind of hard to make two pieces of steel coming together quiet. At one point they were suggesting to put a booth, a soundproof booth, around a drop hammer. Drop hammer is a pretty big instrument, weighing anywhere from 100,000 to 250,000 pounds in our case, and there are bigger kinds of hammers. We have tried to take the position that you cannot do this. It's inoperative. It would involve putting a robot inside a booth and trying to run a machine, and you just can't do it. Manufacturers of this kind of equipment have come out and said it's impossible. So we have tried to take the avenue of more effectively protecting the user of the machine through earmuffs and Swedish wool and different kinds of earplugs, and providing him with better protection while he's running the machine.
Chuck, I'd like to know your feelings on the parking situation in Meadville. There's a survey being circulated now to find out if merchants would be willing to pick up the tab of parking to provide it free, quote unquote, to customers and people shopping in town. How do you feel about this as a merchant? Is it a responsibility of business to pick up a service like this, first of all?
I think if the business in Meadville, businessmen in Meadville, desire to do business in Meadville, they need to have a place for the customers to park. And the biggest competition they have right now is the malls, where it's free parking. And it's known fact, people will walk a quarter of a mile up a mall lot to get to a store, but they won't walk 100 yards downtown. And it's free parking. People don't like to get tickets. I think in that regard, Meadville is going to have to go eventually to free parking. They were one of the first in the country, I think it was, to put in meters, and I think we should be one of the first to take them out.
Hello, my name is Kathleen Wenzel of the Meadville Area Chamber of Commerce, and I would like to welcome you to Chamber Vision. This month, we are going to concentrate our efforts in showing you the colorful history of our area and the many recreational opportunities that abound here in Crawford County.
Nature is always close at hand in Crawford County. From the famous Linesville Spillway, where the ducks walk on the fish, to Pomutuming's Waterfowl Museum, and the Fish Commission's Hatchery and Aquarium. Our lakes and streams also provide the widest variety of active water sports available. From the water skiing and paddle boat cruises of Conneaut Lake, to the Serenity of Canadota Lake, or a canoe trip down the gentle bends of French Creek. Back on land, our county boasts a variety of excellent golf courses, public and private camping facilities, and hiking, biking, and nature trails. August brings the Crawford County Fair, one of the largest agricultural fairs in Pennsylvania. At Conneaut Lake Park, a 40-ride amusement park offers old favorites like a vintage carousel and a roller coaster, and now attractions such as the Otter Creek Adventure River Ride, the first expansion to the park's water-related attractions. For nostalgia buffs, the Oil Creek and Titusville Railroad offers excursion trains on a scenic rail line that retraces the history of the boom towns of oil country. Wintertime brings the added attractions of downhill and cross-country skiing, snowmobiling, skating, and ice fishing.
Now on TV, the meetings of the Pencrest School Board.
Teachers, administrators do more than one thing than select books, and I'm not defending the position, nor am I saying that we did something wrong, nor am I saying that the selection of Eric on the textbook was a mistake. I think that remains to be seen. But I do appreciate you coming and stating your facts as you have in the way that you have done that. And I think in the future, any more kinds of comments or concerns, I think you need to start attending the work sessions and the board meetings, become involved in what's happening. Because as many as you can see around you, we do $1 million business or plus a month, and there's not too many people here that are interested in seeing that. Thanking the cable system now, at least the people in Sagertown will be able to see what's going on, maybe pay more attention.
Pencrest School Board meetings on the Total Public Affairs Channel, CTV-13. Public affairs coverage, the new CTV-13 commitment, now extends to the meetings of the Vernon Township Supervisors.
That the supervisors or the township was the only ones allowed to have a dump other than the people who were grandfathered in, and at that time there was only one other dump.
Well, this is not.
So I think if somebody could check that ordinance out, I think it would fall under that.
This is not an approved situation. None of it's approved. I mean, it's just this gentleman, as I understand it, just taking on his own to just start dumping.
Mr. Longo gave him 30 days to clean it up, so he's got to clean it up in 30 days or we'll take it further from that point.
I'm just interested to hear Mr. Elway say that the township was allowed to have a dump. Is that correct?
If we so desire. At this time, I don't believe it's desirable.
The supervisors of Vernon Township, now on CTV-13, the Total Public Affairs Channel.
The question they have in their own minds with regard to whether or not the citizens of this community want fluoridation. My own judgment is, Your Honor, that a well-organized, very vocal minority has overwhelmed the majority in this case. I am personally convinced that the people at really are concerned about fluoridation are the people who will not sit down because they're taking care of children, because they have responsibilities in the home, because they have responsibility to their families. People like myself, quite frankly, who are doing things and involving themselves in a way that you just don't have time to sit down and move away from your four or five or two or three children and write a letter to the council and say, hey, look, fellas, I'm concerned about fluoridation. I submit to this council that if it's petitions they want endorsing fluoridation, I suspect that it wouldn't take too long a period of time to get a majority of the community to present those petitions to the council. I am convinced of the beneficial effects that fluoridation can have. I am satisfied, and I suppose if I had the time, I could rebut each and every argument that Mr. DeMary has presented, as well as the arguments that the others have advanced as well. Unfortunately, I think the issue was decided long before it was presented to the council. I, in my own mind, in my own judgment, believe that the issue is an issue that was decided on the basis of a political political context. I'm upset that it's come to this.
I want to make myself clear on this thing. I don't think these 900 people or 1,200 are wrong. I don't think they're wrong. I think they have a point of view. There is such a thing as a point of view, and I think they have the right to that point of view.
You see, I don't dispute that at all.
And I don't, please believe me, when this word political bothers me, because if it's political because you're worried about votes, I'm not worried about votes. I'm not worried about votes. But I do care what people think, and I don't care necessarily about the basis for that point of view. I we're living in a country where this is their right. And I don't think that it's up to me to brainwash them or to try to teach them something else. I think if we can't live in a country where people are intelligent enough about even making private mistakes, then this isn't the country to live in. There are other countries where people will decide what's best for you from before the cradle to after the grave.
Do you favor reevaluating the tax-exempt status of not-for-profit industries not-for-profit entities that seemingly compete with for-profit enterprises?
Certainly I do. And I understand how many nonprofits are in a difficult situation attempting to do charitable work. That is, where does the money come from when you do charitable work? What many of them have found is that being in business that competes with the private sector, of course, is where they can get the money. And that has been the logic that many nonprofits have used to explain why they should remain tax exempt. That is, they have to do something in order to raise the money to do their charitable work. I think, however, a number of relatively large nonprofits have overstepped those bounds, and there have been subsidiary companies, et cetera, investing, and the connections are often very blurred. I think definitely that we need to do this. I know that reassessment monies were included in the tax reform package for any municipalities or taxing bodies that wish to do reassessing. I know that a number of court cases where nonprofits, large nonprofits, have been challenged, indeed those nonprofits have lost their status.
Tax-exempt properties has been a problem throughout the Commonwealth for years. The city of Harrisburg, of course, with the state capital, has over 50% tax-exempt property. In Meadville, we have over 30%, but between 34 and 35% that's tax-exempt. But of course, that's only one part of tax reform. But I believe that the General Assembly should define more clearly what tax-exempt really means in terms of the institutions that are or are not eligible to be tax-exempt. I believe that there should be a re-evaluation, as you've stated, periodically without having to be challenged. I think that tax-exempt agencies, every 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, whatever, should have to come to a board, the assessment board or whatever, and they should have to show me, why do you still deserve your tax-exempt status?
Good evening and welcome to Election 75, and thank you very much for joining us. We hope to, throughout this evening, to provide you with the up-to-the-minute returns from the 67 districts of Crawford County. The polls opened this morning at 7 o'clock and they closed just 30 minutes ago at 8 on what could be the most exciting general election we've had in Crawford County for a good many years. I personally have been watching Crawford County elections for 26 years, 18 of those 26 years in the capacity of a news reporter or associated with the news media in one way or another. And the term that is used most generally to describe general elections here in Crawford County is lackluster. There usually isn't too much excitement. But this year, 1975, things were different. We had the retention issue of the two judges in the county. This turned out to be a lot more exciting than most people thought, and controversial in nature too. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. And also the second race that has created some excitement is the contest for district attorney between Ballard Smith and Joseph Kowicki. There were charges and countercharges throughout that campaign, and time will tell how the electorate received the information from both candidates. We have no computer here at CTV-13. We're not like ABC, CBS, or NBC. If we had a computer, it might take the fun out of it, as many people believe. We would be able to feed our first reports into the computer and tell you how things were going to come out. We can't do that, but we can give you the very early returns that we have received in our newsroom. And these returns are from Townville. And it's interesting to note that Townville, last primary, was the first district to report to us. The second district to report was Meadville First Ward First District. And then at 9:05, Vernon First District reported. And then Meadville First Ward Second District at 9:07. We're going to see how the lineup comes in this year as far as time is concerned. But right now we will talk about the early Townville report. On the retention issue in Townville, F. Joseph Thomas received 70 yes votes and 28 no votes. P. Richard Thomas, 56 yes votes and 37 no votes. And in order of the count for county commissioners, Kerr, Turner, and Lamb in that order, and for district attorney, Smith, 80, and Kulwicki, 30. So if we were to project, if we had a computer, which we don't, We would feed this information into it, and we would see at the end of the evening whether Townville reflected what the other communities and other precincts would reflect.
If you were to win tonight, what's the first thing you want to look at? I know if you win tonight, I'm going to come back and ask this question anyhow, but what kind of things, where's the future for Meadville?
Free parking?
I like to hear the sound of that already.
You knew that was coming, didn't you? No, that would be one of many issues. I think we need to look at the overall direction the city's going, see if we can change any operations to conserve money, avoid raising taxes. The free parking is an issue, of course. A new zoning ordinance that preserves single-family residential zoning, that's important, and at the same time allows flexibility of use in transitional areas to allow the expansion of the business community as needed.
As you went out to vote today, and I don't know, are you both in the same precinct or
no
different? Your precinct, Dale, how was turnout today when you went out?
Apparently it was pretty good. When I had gotten there, there was only like, I think 324 is what I was, and we have about 1,200, so that didn't seem real good at the time, but around 6:30, I had heard that there was like 711 through at that point in time, so that's a pretty good turnout.
What ward is that?
1-2.
1-2, okay. How about you, Jim? How about yours?
Turnout in my ward's usually pretty bad in an off year because we have a lot of transients. We have college students who have no interest in any kind of local election.
Sure.
So if I get 30%, maybe 28%, I'd be really happy.
All right, Jim Roha and Dale Nichols are two council candidates from the Republican Party. We'll send it back to Jim Cook. Jim?
Thank you very much, Gary, and council candidates Roha and Nichols for being with us so far. I'm sure that we'll have you back on again. Just to look at some hard figures here for a second, we do have those numbers from Meadville 4th Ward for you to look at. And you see that incumbent Councilman Richmond polled 39 votes, incumbent Councilwoman Hall 41 votes, Roha and Nichols 54 votes each. That's one of nine districts reporting. If you figure that there were around 55 voters who turned out there, that's about 25% turnout in the 4th Ward.
Hi, Jack Christie from Sports Close Up here on Channel 13. 1985 is going to be a great year in sports for Crawford County, and I want you to join me every Monday and Friday evening on Sports Close Up, where I'm going to be interviewing a lot of sports personalities from around the area, college coaches, college players, high school players, and also high school coaches and various organizations around the community. So join me with Sports Close Up Monday at 6:30 and Friday at 5:30 p.m. on Channel 13.
Last year, the Meadville Bulldogs knocked on the door to the District 10 Championship, but the Erie Prep team would not let them in. This year, the opponent is Erie Tech, as the Dogs travel to Edinburgh again with the hopes of bringing the championship home. CTV 13 will provide same-night coverage of the big game in its entirety, beginning at 11 p.m. this Saturday evening. Cablecast coverage of the game will be replayed on Monday, March 11th at 8 p.m. Tune in to CTV 13 and watch the Dogs go to the hoop.
Welcome back to Sports Close-Up. I'm talking with Tom Arrigan, Bill Sherry, talking about basketball officiating. And in this part of our program, we're going to talk about some specific instances on the court that the official has to pay particular attention to, the different lines as far as 3 seconds, and also pay particular attention to the backcourt violations and also lack of action, so on. And we're going to talk about that right now. So, Tom, we have this transparency on right now, and what do we see there?
Well, we see the figure four in a white coming from his backcourt into his front court. And this rule was changed last year. It used to be that it was possible for you to get maybe perhaps your feet in the front court and bounce a ball in the backcourt and be called for over and back. The rule now states that all 3 points must be in the front court before the player has come from back to front court. In figure one, the player has a foot on the division line, 1 point, and he's still on the back court. Figure two, now he has a foot in the front court and one on the division line. Many fans at this stage of the game might think the player is definitely in the front court. But figure three shows him throwing the ball to a player coming out of the deeper back court, and this is a perfectly legal act. The next thing I think we need to point out is the basis for this. Again, we have in figure one, we have the player coming from his back to front court. He has 1 foot in the front court. He's still in the back court. Now he puts a ball down in the front court, but he has his rear foot in the back court as well. So he's still in the back court. Finally, now he has all 3 points in the front court, both feet in the ball. Now he is truly in back court. And if he steps back on the line, which is in back court, or passes into the back court, this is an over and back violation.
All right. The idea now, as you mentioned before, is he must have all 3 points in the front court before he's determined being in the front court.
Absolutely.
If 1 point isn't in back court, why, then he's considered back court. Now, the possibility of both feet in the front court and bouncing the ball in the back court.
Could very easily happen. He could stand with both feet. He could stand with his back to his basket. I don't have a transparency to show that. And with both feet in the front court and stand there and continually bounce the ball and have it strike the floor in the back court, and that would mean that he is still in back court simply because the ball has never touched the front court.
Latrobe is trailing by 1-7-6. All right, a turnover. Turnover for the Bulldogs. Bliss has it, bringing up the right side. Puts it in, looked like the alley-oop, and up.
Great block by Lindsay.
Rejected by Anthony Lindsay. And out of bounds. Another turnover for the Bulldogs.
Meadville's pressures defensively is doing a good job.
All right. Bliss has it. Looked like a foul. Foul on number 23. That's the second foul on Keith Fenton.
The foul is on number 23, Keith Fenton. That is his second, 15-4.
7-6, Meadville leads. 5:16 left in the first quarter. Gary Chaney going to inbound the ball. Full court press by the Wildcats.
It's a straight man
Hero
press.
Bringing it up. Good pressure. Hero goes through the pressure. Chaney, good
nice
inside move.
Chaney, very, very nice move on Chaney. Took it through the pressure and then spun off.
That's Gary's first field goal. Paul Burnett on a steal. Passes it back to Lindsay. Lindsay misses the layup shot. Rebounded by Dave Stahl, and he's fouled by Lindsay. That's Lindsay's first foul. Scoring this far, Paul Burnett has two field goals, one foul for 5 points. Chaney and Mike Burnett at one foul goal, field goal each. 9-6 Meadville leads. Inbound right there, Neil Fenton. That's his third field goal. Pressure all the way over the court by Latrobe Wildcats. Burnett on a missed shot. Neil Fenton up with it, passes it off, but loses a ball. And Stahl, fighting for it on the floor, comes up with it. And we see that we have a jump ball called by Uzzolano, Bob Uzzolano. All right, Stahl and Pirro. Bad throw by
again.
The official. They'll throw it up again. Sometimes, John, officials let that go, and they shouldn't, but they were a quick whistle with it.
That's why they took it out of the college game. It was just administered so poorly.
All right, tap control by Paul Burnett of Meadville.
Paul's doing a nice job handling the
Meadville.
Ball.
Pirro on a drive into Lindsay. Good assist for Mike Pirro, and the Bulldogs take a 3-point lead. Lamondola split to the left, Vanessi tight now. And there's a reverse pass play. Lamondola puts it in the air. Up goes Vanessi. He misses it. And Greenwood, defending against the play, knocked that ball away. But that was a little bit of a trick play there, Tom. It just might have worked.
That was a reverse handoff to Lamondola with a halfback pass down to the tight end, Vanessi. And Vanessi was open for a split second there. Excellent defensive coverage by the Westminster Titans on that play.
That was Sam Greenwood, number two. The veteran defensive corner. Veteran Sam Greenwood, number two, the veteran defensive corner. Putting the mic too far away here. Trace once again in that long count, gives it to Phibbs. Phibbs bullying his way through there for about 2 or 3 yards. If you don't hear me, ladies and gentlemen, I seem to be putting the mic away from my mouth here too much, and then next thing you know, I remember to get it back up there. Jim Cook just grabbed my hand and pushed it back up there, so I think I'll remember now.
Well, again, you're trying every play to get a score on the board, and they're trying to open the offense up a little bit. Tackles for Allegheny, doing a tremendous job, opening up some nice holes up the middle.
All right, the fans getting into the game now for the game for the Titans. Long count again by Trace. Fakes it to Phibbs. Trace taking the avenue, and there goes Trace. If he keeps up his speed, he's taking it all the way. And Trace all the way into the end zone. A 44-yard touchdown run on an option play by Don Trace. Beautiful.
We're starting with Bill Lynn, our number 3 qualifier, bowling on lane 17. We're here at Plaza Lanes today, 22-lane house. It's been a good tournament. We've had exciting finishes right down to the end, with John Lee just making the finals in the last game.
Bill Lynn's off to a good start. He left the 7-pin standing in the corner. Bill set the pace last week when he came from out of the pack with that 300 game and home and nearly had another 300 to lead the rankings last week.
Billy had a little bit of tough luck today. He lost.
Billy opened with a spare. Now we'll see John Lee come up. John helped put the tournament together, and I might say, Greg, you and John did a heck of a good job on this. John coming from number 12 in the pack to get into the Final Four is quite an accomplishment.
Certainly is. John rolled 277 his first game and jumped up about 8 places right off the bat.
That's coming in good. John starts off with a nice 10 count.
They're both playing about the same angle, Chuck. They're going to both play somewhere between the 8th to the 10th board. In a bowling alley, you have 39 boards, and most of your better bowlers do what we call spot bowling. They're going to try to pick a certain board or an arrow out and hit that. So they're both going to be around the 8th to 8th board to the second arrow thing.
John's got another chance. He's got another chance.
Oh, he starts out with double.
And John's off and running.
Helen and Jim Lang welcome you to the dining experience of the Villa. The Villa Restaurant, where you'll enjoy fine American and Italian cuisine, seafood, steaks, and pasta, in a quiet, relaxing atmosphere. Dinner specials from $4.95, served Monday through Thursday. Before or after dinner, sip your favorite libation in the Villa's comfortable lounge. Open the door to casual dining excellence. Open the door to the Villa.
Enjoy the best of both worlds at Charlie's. If you have a lot of time for lunch or dinner, choose from Charlie's regular menu of taste-tempting entrees and sandwiches. But if speedy service is your need, try the Active People's menu with meals for people on the go. All orders are cooked to your specifications by Charlie's experienced staff and served courteously to you at your table. Meet your friends for cocktails and lunch or dinner at Charlie's Restaurant and Pub on the Conneaut Lake Road.
And this word is worth $25 if you're successful in guessing it. We'll retire the four-letter word, and we'll get ready to start the word game in just a moment. We do want to take this opportunity, however, to remind you that next week, Channel 13 is 10 years old. We'll be celebrating all week long with special programming. And tonight, we are very honored that the Honorable Mayor of the City of Meadville, Mayor Richard C. Ruhlman, has stopped by to pay a visit. So we're going to introduce Mayor Ruhlman at this time. And again, Mayor, we wish you to come right over here and visit with us. And we thank you very much for taking this time from your busy schedule to stop by.
Jim, thank you very much. It's right now it's a busy dinner hour, and it's only a short interruption. I want to present to you and to announce to your audience that we have prepared a proclamation, I think, appropriate to this auspicious occasion. May I read it? Proclamation. Only two whereases. Whereas, cable television, Channel 13, service of Meadville Master Antenna, has become a vital force in our local system of communications. And whereas CTV-13, widely recognized as a pioneer in local program origination, celebrates 10 years of cable casting local programs for the greater Meadville area on June 4th, 1977. Therefore, I, Richard J. Ruhlman, Mayor of the City of Meadville, do hereby declare the period May 31st to June 4th, 1977 to be CTV 13 week in Meadville in recognition of 10 years of exemplary service rendered by Channel 13 to the people of Meadville. And signed with our seal, Richard J. Ruhlman, May 26, 1977.
Thank you very much, Mayor, and we'll be placing this in a real place of honor here at Channel 13, and we do thank you for recognizing our efforts. It's been a real pleasure to work with the City of Meadville and your office.
Program Jill Invites is on every day. Won't you please be my guest?
I'm Doug Miles. Won't you join me behind the cameras here at Channel 13?
Hello, I'm the story lady.
Hi, sports fans. I'm Tony Stellato. If you are interested in local sports and athletics, be sure to watch Sports Close-Up on Cablecast Television, Channel 13.
Hi, I'm Jim Strickler, and each week we talk to some very important people on our interview program on Cablecast 13. Won't you join us next week for Interview 13? Fishing, hunting, passions, politics, baseball, football, golf, stories, children, news, music, antiques, cooking, flowers, fairs, fly tying, and tennis. Find it all and more on Cablecast Channel 13, local television for Meadville, Segertown, and Conneaut Lake.
We see a float coming into view. Cup Scout Pack 212 from Neeson Hill School.
And one of my very favorite Disney characters there on the front.
Donald Duck.
212 making a lot of noise.
We even see Santa Claus on the float. We hear a lot of high moms when these youngsters pass by.
All right. Quiet for a second. What number is your troop number? They're good. All right, now we have...
Following, we have the Girl Scout troop. 628.
628, I can't
read. We see three little ducks in the front. Is that Huey, Dewey, and Louie?
Yeah. All types of characters here tonight. I wonder how many E.T. characters we're going to see.
I'm not sure. Was he a Disney character?
E.T.?
I'm not. I know that he's a new... But I wasn't sure whether he was from Disney.
No, he wouldn't fit that category, but I'm sure we'll see some E.T. characters.
Winner in the youth float competition.
And here again, we have a winner, Dottie, and they're receiving the trophy.
And they have done Cinderella's...
Presents the trophy.
Cinderella's chariot coach out of a pumpkin... With the crown on top.
And
nice job for the
Girl Scouts. Take home a trophy.
Second prize.
All right.
Now coming into view.
Really, you should be the French Creek Valley Antique Auto Club. Let's hear your motors.
Coming into view, as just announced, the French Creek Valley Antique Auto Club.
Can't hear that.
And we're going to see a lot of beautiful automobiles, as we do each year.
Leading the very first car that we have here, and I didn't ask him what year it was or what model, but John Snyder is the president of the French Creek Valley Antique Automobile Club. Each of these cars must be at least 25 years old or older in order to qualify to be an antique automobile. These have all been restored. Most of them by their owners. They spend hours and hours.
Entrance number 29, the French Creek Valley Antique Auto Club.
We don't know how many units there will be in this particular entry, but...
There were about 16 up along the parade route. We see John and Linda. Give us a wave.
Must be in front or engines will boil over.
And Emil's just talking about one of the problems with the antique cars. You have to have the cars in the front of the parade because their engines overheat if they're delayed. Here we have two characters. Are they Disney characters?
One looks like one of the Laurel and Hardy characters and a clown.
Oh,
very well done.
Very well done is right.
It takes an awfully long time to prepare these floats, and some of these floats have been in preparation for a number of weeks.
And if we could, get you folks just to stop for one moment, please.
On for about 3 weeks now. This is the YWCA youth float and the Y teens.
We would like to present you. This is the first place float in the youth float competition tonight.
Their theme was a big hand, a big round of applause. But the games people play at the YWCA.
And we do understand that this was a winner. Some of these were prejudged.
Boy, there sure is a variety on that float.
A lot of games there at the YW to be played. And of course, both the YM and YW stress physical fitness. And they're exercising to demonstrate that aspect of games people play. And this float, we understand, is a winner. We don't know exactly what place, but we do understand that it was judged a winner. And you're looking at some of the costumes. There's a dice.
Here we have the Northwestern Pennsylvania Lamb and Wool Queen. Her name is Betty Miller. Interesting thing about this is she has to, that what she's sitting on is wool as well as what she wears is wool.
I wonder if as part of it she had to make the outfit. Some of the queens have to make their own outfits, I know.
I bet you she did. Yes, that's Jackie Canfield, the 1984 Miss Sweet 16 Steam Queen.
And this car is owned by John Wilmarth. It's a 1955 Packard Clipper. And John enters his units in the parade each year, and each year they seem to get a little shinier. I think he puts more wax on them.
Up next is the first of our many float winners this evening, taking second place in the youth division. The Saddle Up 4-H Club, they took second place. It's a haunted house with ghosts and goblins as the meeting place for the annual Monster Mash. Saddle Up 4-H Club is a horse club and has 20 members. John Schilling, Brenda Miller, and Anna Batchdell are the leaders. Members participating in making the float: Angela, Tabitha, Jeremy, Nikki, Jeremy, Melanie, and Tammy. Articles on the float were made and donated by the members and their families. Congratulations, second place. We have another float winner making their way to us, the Meadville Tribune. Took first place in the commercial division. Meadville Tribune, first place in the commercial division. Meadville Tribune salutes the super movies with Superman. Clark Kent, the mild-mannered reporter, stands in the newsroom of the Daily Planet when he learns of an impending crime about to take place in the city metropolis. With his sidekicks Lois Lane and photographer Jimmy Olsen, he sets out to investigate. There you go, Ed.
Junior Miss Cochranton, Heidi Hunter. Next, we have another float for you in the community division. This is the USS Endeavor, the Meadville Star Trek fan club. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud to announce that the USS Endeavor Meadville Star Trek fan club, first place in the community division. Terrific job. Good job. This is nonprofit, the Westbury Float. You can see a lot of time and energy went into the Westbury Float. And ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to announce for at least the fifth straight year that the Westbury Float nonprofit is our grand champion. Our grand champion float for the 1994 Meadville JC's Halloween Parade.
Ernie Harmon's, the restaurant that makes dining out a pleasure. Featuring a menu of American and European specialties prepared by Gunther, truly a master chef. Ernie Harmon's, located on the Conneaut Lake Road, serving the best of both worlds. Now, for the first time, you can hold your next private party at Ernie Harmon's, and the entire restaurant will be exclusively yours. Any Monday night, call 724-8300 to reserve your date. Ernie Harmon's on the Conneaut Lake Road.
Fiddler on the roof. Sounds crazy, no? But in our little village of Anatevka, you might say each of us is a fiddler on the roof, trying to scratch out a pleasant, simple tune without breaking his neck. It isn't easy. You may ask, why do we stay up there if it's so dangerous? We stay because Anatevka is our home. And how do we keep our balance? That I can tell you in one word. Tradition!
Tradition! Tradition!
Because of our traditions, we have kept our balance for many years. Here in Nanatevka, we have our traditions for everything. How to eat, how to sleep, how to work, even how to wear clothes. For instance, we always keep our heads covered, and we always wear a little prayer shawl. This shows our constant devotion to God. You may ask, how did these traditions start? Well, I'll tell you, I don't know. But they're traditions. And because of these traditions, each of us knows who he is and what God expects him to do.
Who day and night must scramble for a living, feed a wife and children, say his daily prayers, and who has the right as master of the house to have the final word at home? The papa, the papa, tradition, the papa. Hebrew school, at 10 I learned a trade. I hear they picked a bride for me. I hope she's pretty. The sons, the sons. Tradition, the sons, the sons. Tradition.
And who does Mama teach to mend and tend and fix? Preparing me to marry whoever Papa picks.
The daughters, the daughters. Tradition, the daughters, the daughters. Tradition.
This afternoon at 5:15. All the action in Allegheny's Robertson Field. This is the Russian 5th and 6th grade football team.
Snap from center, they'll hand it right to the punter. Malinowski, standing at his own 45, will boot the ball away. Taken by the up man, the Russian team, who's at the 30, running to the far side to the 35, still on his feet to the 40, to the 45, to the 50, down the far side, the 35, 30, 25, 20. He is going to go all the way for a touchdown. That's Eugene Chekhov, who goes the distance.
Now the teams will shake hands in the traditional post-game ceremony you might see in the National Hockey League. And this is another gesture of sportsmanship as the teams will line up and shake hands and put to an end an exciting day for us, Ray, and it's just continuing to go here at Robertson Field. Of course, game two will follow between the 7th and 8th graders.
They'll go for two now. Birkbile under center. With the full backfield, Birkbile roams right. He'll go long ways right around the corner. He's in for the two-point conversion. It's 8-0 Meadville. James Birkbile has all 8 points. And the Bulldogs, with 7:04 to go in the second quarter, have taken that lead
pack your lunch and you make sure you take certain things that aren't common. Okay, there's the kickoff.
All right, and the Russians will pick it up. That's Ignatkov, and he goes around the other side. Ignatkov's off into the races. He's going to go 78 yards for a touchdown. No flags down. It's 8-6. Bob, an exciting game, but the Bulldogs win it by an 8-6 count with no scoring in the third and fourth quarter, but good game for these two teams.
Oh, it certainly was. It was an excellent game, very competitive, and I think all sides and everybody involved in this whole event have to be very happy and very pleased.